it's one thing to talk about culture, but you can't address it directly. You have to come at it obliquely through all the sort of interstitial tissue in between of processes and people. Business is messy and unpredictable.
Sometimes lonely.
So lonely.
So lonely.
And inspiration can often come from really weird places.
We pick up where the bullet point blogs and the highlight reels leave off.
We start with the stories. Welcome back to So Here's My Story. I'm Jody.
I'm Elliot.
And I'm Joe.
And Joe.
Who's Joe?
Yes.
Who's this guy in the room?
Well, I'll tell you who this guy in the room is. So Joe, at least at this point, Joe and I go back for like decades now.
Wow.
Yeah, we go back quite a ways.
I'm just meeting Joe today, but whatever.
Yeah, absolutely one of my favorite people on the planet. I met him in a former life when he was doing more marketing and branding. He is a UX expert, which sounds so much cooler than just saying user experience. It's UX. And I will say a diehard Cleveland Browns fan who I believe is about to be rewarded from his long, long cold winter in the NFL hinterlands by a resurgent team in Cleveland. So we welcome Joe Natoli to the podcast.
Joe, thank you. My time has come.
It's great to have you. Joe tells a really fantastic story going all the way back to his senior year in high school that gets us into all sorts of fantastic leadership topics, from how to get to the root cause of a problem, to culture, to dealing with fears, to saying no to clients. There's just so much goodness here. You are definitely going to stick around.
So here's my story. I grew up in a tiny town, Girard, Ohio, smack in the middle of Ohio, that you could drive through in about 3 minutes. Okay. Tiny town. There were three towns right next to each other that were driven by two industries, steel mills and automotive. General Motors was there. All right. So everybody that came to these three towns, which was predominantly Italian immigrants, came to do labor work.
Right.
Okay. That was the deal. And that drove the economy. There's nothing else there. To this day, there's nothing else there. And of course, the steel mills died out and now there's even less of nothing there. Anyway, at the time I was a senior in high school, I was an artistic kid. I was a dreamer. I was a big thinker. I had very little patience for lots of aspects of the discipline and strictness of school. So you get to be a senior and your parents and everyone around you is going, okay, what do you want to do with your life? You're going to go to college.
Which is a great conversation when you're 17, 18 years old.
Yeah.
Right.
Because you're perfectly ready for that.
Yeah. What do you want to do with your life? I have no idea. I'm 18. Like, it's the last thing on your mind and you can't even fathom.
Right.
Right. I think you can't even get there. And, you know, having kids, they can't get there either.
So absolutely
you,
not.
Kids, you go through the same thing.
Sure.
Right. Anyway, my father is worried that I'm going to be a starving artist my entire life, because when I mentioned, well, I think I want to do something art related, that's what's in his
head. Did the skin bubble on his body?
Yeah, like, he's like, he used to point out junker cars to me. If we were like driving and he'd see like a broken down car, he'd go, see that car? That's what you're going to be driving if you wind up being a starving
artist. That doesn't produce any anxiety.
No, not at all. Not at all. So my uncle, his brother was an architect, right? So he kind of felt like, well, maybe that's close because it's creative. And he wasn't wrong about that.
Yeah.
But the more I learned about architecture, it didn't hold any interest for me. So here's my dilemma. I got to pick a school. I got to pick a program. And I have no clue what I want to do. Well, prevailing wisdom is you have a guidance counselor at the high school who is there to guide you. Again, tiny town, a little small-minded, right? Just a little context here. So I go to the guidance counselor's office and I, as earnestly as possible, pitch my thing. I want to do something creative. I want to do something art related. I don't know what that is. I don't know what's available to me, but these are the things that I'm really extraordinarily good at.
Yeah. He says with hopeful eyes.
Yeah.
Like I could just see like 17-year-old you being like, here are my dreams. Direct me.
Totally right. Okay. At an age where you're really not comfortable opening yourself up in any way. And I certainly wasn't.
Right.
Okay. Because if you're a sensitive kid in a small town,
keep that to yourself.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Because that sensitivity will get stepped on repeatedly. Yep. And it did from the time I was a little kid.
Sure. Right?
That was just constant.
Right.
You know, that was my thing. So I'm in this office. I'm like, okay, here's my deal. What do I do with my life? And this guy looks at me and he says, well, I think your best bet is probably to go join the army.
Really? Yeah. They have a lot of graphic designers in the army.
Apparently. I mean, I didn't know this.
So I was like bracing myself because I knew it wasn't going to say like, you should go to art school. Otherwise, this wouldn't be a story. right. But I was like bracing myself, but I didn't even quite swing all the way over to join the army.
Yeah. So why'd he tell you that? What's he thinking?
He's thinking that okay, that's ridiculous. That's a ridiculous job pursuit. That's right. It's the very definition of artsy fartsy, right? It's unrealistic. It's irresponsible. It's, you're a dreamer. You're a, you know, people don't do that. You're going to be a loser, whatever. So he figured, you know, your best bet in life is to take orders from somebody else because you have no marketable skills. Right, you have no acumen. You have no drive.
But he didn't even try to redract your interests. He just shoved them into the garbage disposal. Me. Yeah. At least your dad was trying to find something that was like a more reasonable
art related.
Like, let's take your art thing and try and shove it into something that's more like standard professional career. This guy was just like, no.
Yeah, right. Like, go.
Let's go get that beaten out of you.
Run laps and carry a rifle and whatever else. That was the sum total of his answer to me. And so I was dumbfounded. I mean, I sat there and I remember there was just dead silence because I didn't know what to say. And I was, again, because I was a sensitive kid.
Sure.
You just got that crushed.
Right.
You know, and
after telling him what your dreams were, is a hard thing to do anyway.
And to my credit, and I think part of the reason this story resonates with me so much, it was probably one of the first times I ever stood up for myself. In any way, which strangely enough, I told you about my father and I were at odds and we were fighting. Okay? Right. We were fighting for a solid 2 years about this back and forth. And there was a lot of headbutting, but my response, I literally got from my dad essentially at the same time, teaching me that you don't have to accept what people give you.
Right.
Just because a teacher says this or a leader says this or an adult says this doesn't make it the word. You're allowed to question. You're allowed to think for yourself. And literally, I mean, in any
hats off to your dad. That's a pretty powerful.
Yeah. In any number of ways, he drilled that into me. So I'm sitting there and I'm stunned. And what I come back with is, well, fuck you. And I got up and I walked out. And I went back home and I had, you know, a couple of college catalogs at home. And which, to be honest with you, I hadn't really looked at. So I think this was a catalyst in that way as well. And I remember I sat down with a catalog from Kent State University, which is what I was thinking about because it was an hour from home. Mm-hmm. It was away, but it wasn't too far away.
Right.
And they, I think, made an offer that gave me a little scholarship money or something. And I read the description of graphic design. And as I read it, I thought, okay, this sounds like it's a job, but it's also building on the things that I think I'm good at. And you know, I had no clue. So. Yeah. I took a shot. I said, all right, I'm going to try this and we're going to see where it goes. And I got extraordinarily lucky in that the first class I took when I was at Kent State was called Visual Organization, was taught by a lady named Katie Kennedy, who to this day is one of the most amazing humans I've ever come across. This woman was total fire, total passion. She's just on all the time. You know, everything to her is amazing. It's incredible. It's, you know, she's driven.
Yeah.
And the first stuff that she exposed us to, just dealing with shapes, here's how shapes work together in a visual field, blah, blah, blah. I mean, technically boring stuff, but she lit a fire under my ass that just has never gone away.
Yeah. Well, and that's, I think, such a fascinating thing about this is anything that lights a fire has to be a good thing. Like fire always has to trump sort of dead insideness.
Right. But you think to yourself
right
at that moment, and I think, I honest to God, I think about this all the time. Sitting in that office, I really feel like I could have gone either way.
Oh, 100%.
I was so insecure at the time that I was probably half on the fence to saying, well, okay, you know what? This guy's probably right.
Well, if you had even just so much grown.
I should probably just go take orders
from
somebody else.
But you did wind up kind of reaching the same conclusion in a way, meaning that he came to the conclusion that there's nothing that fits you here.
Right.
Now, of course, his direction was, don't go with anything that fits you. Go with the opposite of that and we'll beat that nonconformist part out of you. You left the meeting and you came to the conclusion that there's nothing that fits me here.
Yeah.
And you decided to go find what fits you.
Find that thing.
Yeah. Yeah, that's accurate. Honest to God, I never thought of that. But that's the truth.
Yeah, it's funny. Sometimes I think I don't have strong opinions about something. And there's a few people I seek out because they are people who will reliably like push back. And it's interesting. It's almost like I'm seeking out your guidance counselor, because there's this person who actually gives me, I won't call it terrible advice, but he always says sort of a little bit.
Please give me some bad advice.
But it's kind of funny. He always sort of, no, it's not you. Shh, nice. Don't tell Elliot. But he'll often say, well, you just need to like X, Y, Z. And the fascinating thing is, I don't think I have a super strong opinion. I think I have like all these options and I can't decide and I'm being indecisive. When he says that, all of a sudden something perks up in me that I fight for something. Yeah. I'm like, no, because I need to, I'm like, oh, that. There it is. Yeah, no, I need not that people. And, but it's just as likely, you know, had you as much grown up in a household with a dad who's like, my way or the highway, you can't even raise an eyebrow at me. Those kids probably sit there and go, oh, okay, that's a fact you just said. There's nothing for me. I should go this path.
No, tragic. And I think that's right. And it's, what you just said is evident in a lot of what I do now, whether it's working with teams inside, you know, a company, mm-hmm. organization, or whether it's talking to students, young designers, young UX folks, which is like every day for me. Mm-hmm. The things that get me off the dime the fastest, the things that provoke the kind of response where it's like, okay, now we're going here and we're going to talk about this and we're going to get to the bottom of it. The stuff that really lights a fire under me is kind of what you described. Mm. The minute I hear about a situation that's unfair, that's untenable, where people are being taken advantage of, where
like opportunities getting shut down in some way.
Right, where people are feeling like they're walking around with their hands tied behind their back and they're not allowed to do their jobs, or they're frustrated, they're banging their head against the wall and nobody cares. Mm-hmm. Those are the types of things where I'm like, I'm putting
you're
on like, the cape.
I can
like,
fix go. This. Yep.
Because this is ridiculous.
It's funny. I think we're very similar. It almost borders on hubris, but in like the best kind of way. Yeah, you're like, oh, sure. I do not accept that this is that's a no answer. Like there has to be a better way.
Well, but and the other thing that strikes me is that it seems, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but a lot of what you do is showing people that they don't have to march in a straight line with 1,000 other people, which was the direction that the guidance counselor was pointing you
That's right.
And quite literally.
Yes.
March in a straight line.
Well, that's exactly right. And so I just kind of like the symmetry of the story with the path you took, and then what you do for a living is to stop people from doing what everybody else around
it gets super
doing,
meta if you think about it for a second. I mean, yes. that if you think of user experience as like life, a whole life experience, yep. like you witnessed it happen in that moment where somebody's like, no, you have to do it this way. You're like, no.
Right.
It has to be a better
absolutely
way.
Right.
So we got into what motivates you and you know, in one direction or another. But so you're in user experience, you know that you don't want things that work because everybody else does the same damn thing, right? So what do you look for? I know you have to have some rules when you approach this problem.
Of course.
What do you look at?
What I'm always looking for, quite honestly, is the place I start in every single engagement, every single conversation is, what are you doing right now?
Hmm.
Right? Walk me through it from start to finish, whether it's here's how we go through a project from the time someone says, we need to, whatever, to the time it gets built and launched. I'm not going to say anything. I want you to walk me through that process. Hmm. And in some cases, let's diagram it out. I want to see all the stuff that's happening.
Okay.
Because here's what's happening. In almost all these cases, they go, well, we're an agile shop, or we follow lean methodology, or our software development process is like this.
Okay.
All right. And there are any number of prescriptions for that. If you hit Google right now and Google Agile, right, you're going to mm-hmm. find a million recipes, dogmatic recipes from start to finish. Here's what you do. Here's how you do it. Here are the rules.
Mm-hmm.
Here's how you integrate UX into that process. Here's how you integrate design in that process. Everybody follows these prescriptions. In 26, 27 years of doing this, I have never walked into a single organization where that is working.
Right.
Why not? Right. What's not working?
Because it's like life. Right? You can the instructions sound great on paper. Everything looks great on paper. It's all nice and ordered and structured, and it all makes perfect logical sense. And then you throw human beings in the mix, and we're messy. We're complicated. We're emotional. There's political pressure. There's all sorts of things that happen inside an organization that have nothing to do with building software.
Mm-hmm.
But those things drive the process, okay? People's fears, for example.
Yeah.
One thing I tell young designers and UXers all the time that are frustrated is look for the fear. If those people are tightly controlling what you're doing, There's a reason.
Like what? Explain that to me. What do you mean?
They're afraid. They're afraid that if they take their hand off the wheel, if they let other people do what ostensibly they hired them to do, that they don't know what's going to happen. Because a lot of people, particularly in the tech field or in the business field, don't really understand UX or design. It's like a black box. Mm-hmm. It's just like graphic design always was. It's like this mystery, right? Creative stuff happens and then stuff comes out the other end. But no one really has a purview into it because it's abstract in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. It's much harder to pin down. So that, I think there's nervousness there, right? I don't know what this is. I don't know how it works. I don't know what it looks like.
So I'm going to maintain strict control.
Yes.
Right. And then when I don't understand something, something could happen and then I can't explain why we did it that way. And therefore I have to like white knuckle hold it.
Correct.
And so, yeah.
And then
people
on my side of the fence make it worse.
Right.
And the way we make it worse is because we use all these big terms and acronyms and we spout about process and principles and best practices and all this stuff. And all you're doing, you're building more obstacles.
Right. And you're separating yourself more and more
stuff that they don't understand. They don't know what those words mean.
See, the use of big terms to obscure communication is something totally unfamiliar to me.
I'm sure.
That is like, if you remove that from law.
No, it doesn't happen in law at all.
No.
Yeah, is that even possible? You know, it's funny. This one isn't fear-based, but like more the frustration side of that same thing I see happen. Sometimes when I'm talking to people, a leader will be really frustrated with like a person who is insisting on not doing a part of the process the way that they're... I'm making air quotes, they're supposed to be.
Yeah.
And they think that this person's solution to it is really, air quotes again, stupid. And it's the same kind of like back up to like, there's probably an unmet need here. Now they're coming at it like a wrong way. In this case, an example came up where this person wanted to create a separate Slack channel for every single one of her clients. And they were like, we can't do that. That would be insane. And the person was like, but I need it because I can't, if they're all in one, I can't tell them apart. And the person I was talking to wanted to just sort of like poo-poo that. She's like, that's ridiculous. We can't have 12. So I was like, right. But back up. You can't just ignore her problem. It means that she's probably out on the lines of noticing a place where your process is going to break for other people too, with more people. And so what's another solution? So I think that's sort of like not reacting, but backing up to what's the fear or the frustration or the thing that's broken.
And that's where you need to focus, right? That's always my entire point. Forget about the recipes that you know. Forget about this stuff that you want to automatically apply. We do that as humans because we're good at it, right?
And it's comfortable.
Yeah, of course.
And to be fair, it you know, the advice out of this, I mean, this is why I always say like opposite things get to be true at the same time. The advice is not recreate every single wheel all the time. And yet,
right,
don't just pull the recipe out and stick it. Yeah.
If you say to me, Joe, we've been doing this the same way for the last 18 months or the last 4 years or whatever it is, and here's where we routinely wind up. Okay, then first of all, stop doing that.
Right.
So, I mean, seriously. And they're like, and I get deer in the headlights looks when I say these things.
Because then what do we do?
Right. Okay. So for instance, and I don't want to get too much into the weeds here, but there's a thing about integrating agile development teams and UX people or designers where, okay, the designers should be working 2 weeks ahead of the developers because that ensures a nice little feedback loop. And by the time these guys make progress, the other guys are ready to see what they're doing, right? Guys and gals. It never works. Mm-hmm. It doesn't ever work. I've never seen it work in a single organization. Okay.
Why not?
Because it becomes, they're trying to avoid what's called waterfall, which is I finish my part and then you can do your part after I'm done with mine. So there's all this time delay built into the process or handoffs. Agile came out as a reaction to all that. It's like, no, we need to be working more closely together, feeding off each other, feedback loops.
In tiny little increments.
Iteration, you know what I mean? Iteration, all that kind of stuff, which makes total sense.
Sounds good.
The problem is when you implement it that way, you're back to walls. These guys aren't done with their stuff, so I can't do my stuff. And I haven't seen what they're doing, so I don't know what they're doing. And I'm charging down my own path. And then they come up with something that's the complete antithesis of what I thought it was. So I say, like, just forget all that. All right? The hell with it. Forget it. Stop doing it. Pick your lead, if you have more than one UX person, which most people don't. Pick your lead guy on the UX or design side. Pick your lead guy on the development side. And those people sit together twice a day, if not all day.
Yeah.
Twice a day, they get together and they say, where are you at? What are you doing? Here's what I'm doing. What do you think? Did I paint myself in any corners? Am I painting you in any corners? That's all it is. Forget about all this artifice. Forget about deliverables. Forget about structure and product. I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to each other at least twice a day, specifically every single day. Forget about this 2 week. Just forget it. It's not working.
Do you know where I saw this? This just came up in another, because we're talking about software, but I want to kind of globalize the conversation here for a minute, because I get these questions a lot of times, like, you know, what's your, like, what are important things I should include in my leadership team meetings, or what are these things? Yeah, and people are looking for recipes, which I get. Like, I don't want to start from scratch. I don't want endless lists of things when I'm trying to do something new. So it's great to pull from those things. But I always say, like, well, how about you get your team together and say, what are the things that we can only do when we're together? And what do we really need to do here? And what doesn't matter? Because otherwise you end up reviewing things because they're on the checklist. And I'm like, here are some things that you might want to think about adding. But ultimately, like, what do you need out of that meeting? As opposed to, like, having a meeting because you're supposed to have a meeting. And just kind of getting the questions in the right order.
So exactly one of the, right. And so what that brings me to is, when you started out, you said that what doesn't work very often is this linear thing. It looks great on paper and it doesn't quite work because human beings are messy. They're not logical. They bring all this stuff. So is that communication piece? Or my overall question was, well, then how do you, if the recipe won't work because human beings are there and human beings are naturally going to be injected into the process, how do you account for that? How do you make sure that everything humans bring to the table is in the process? Is that one of the ways? Or
yeah, well, it is. It's and that's the reason I have this exhaustive, show me what you're doing now. And let's diagram it and let's talk about it. I did that same kind of exercise once. For instance, organization had four different departments, mm-hmm. right? They got grant money to develop X product, right? They had to spec it out up front and say, this is what we're going to build. And, you know, the arbiters of the funding, public funding, say, okay, we'll give it to you.
Okay.
They have to build exactly that to the letter. Here's what they found. 2 years in a row, they got all the way to the finish line. They built something that was not.
Really?
Not anywhere, in some cases, nowhere near what the spec was. So they lost their funding. This happened twice.
Wow.
And they're going, how is this possible? So I sat with every department. I didn't do anything but nothing more complicated than what I just described to you. Tell me what you're doing from the time someone says, okay, we're going to start, to the time something gets built. And we diagrammed it. Okay. I boxes and arrows. I just drew everything out. And I asked questions along the way. And whenever when someone says, well, and then you might as well take a vacation because it's going to be 5 weeks before that person gets back to you. I get a red marker. I note it. Okay, so we did that with four departments, 4 days. What I saw, number one, is that everybody's doing everybody else's job. Everybody's rewriting specifications documents. Mm. Everybody's rewriting communications. There's misinformation everywhere.
Sounds like a game of telephone.
I was just going to say that.
So on the fifth day, we get everybody together and I share this.
All four departments?
Yeah.
Okay.
And they're shocked. Nobody has any idea this is going on to the degree that it is.
So you're making the invisible visible.
Right.
Yeah.
So ostensibly, I'm hired to help fix UX, right? The product has to be better. The end result has to be better. But this is all part of that. Okay. Unless you deal with this stuff, the obstacles that get in the way of a good end result of anything is very rarely, in my opinion, you guys can tell me what you think. It's very rarely people's ability. It's very rarely their skill. It's very rarely their experience. It's all this bullshit that happens
right
on the periphery that builds obstacles to doing things the right way.
Well, it's so interesting because it sounds like UX flows in the same way that like, say, culture does. You know, it's one thing to talk about culture, but you can't address it directly. You have to come at it obliquely through all the sort of interstitial tissue in between of processes and people and things like that.
So that's our story.
But the discussion doesn't have to end here.
No, it does not.
In fact, we don't want it to.
No, we don't.
That is why we actually have our private Facebook group,
which we started to make sure that we could get your comments, your rants, your thoughts.
Your stories. You can find links to that group as well as show notes and links to subscribe via email and how to find us just about anywhere you can possibly find podcasts at sohere'smystory.com.
And you can also find us on Facebook and Twitter at SHMS Podcast.
And since we know it takes a village.
Yes, it does.
We'd like to thank our village, our super talented, incredibly patient team.
And occasionally snarky team.
Yeah, but in the best of ways.
In the best
lovingly
of ways.
Snarky. Yes. Good mockery.
So a huge shout out to the people who actually help us produce our show. First, our sound engineer, Tom Hansen.
Thanks to Christy Schmier for our brilliant show notes and all the other fantastic writing she does for us.
And to Taylor Mathauer for doing just a little bit of everything.
Including wrangling us.
Including wrangling us.
Which is no small feat.
No, it's not.
This is Jody Hume.
And I'm Elliot Wagenheim.
And you've been listening to So Here's My Story.